See if St. Lucie County's ship is finally coming into the port of Fort Pierce, next on Inside St. Lucie. Hello and welcome to this edition of Inside St. Lucie, SLCTV's monthly government affairs show. I'm your host, Erick Gill, Communications Division Director for St. Lucie County. And on today's show, we'll be diving into the Port of Fort Pierce with my guests, St. Lucie County Commissioner Chris Dzadovsky and County Administrator Howard Tipton. But before we meet our guests, here's some upcoming events and announcements from the Board of County Commissioners.
St. Lucie County offices and attractions will be closed Monday, January 15th for the observance of the Martin Luther King Jr. holiday. Join us in the studio for Covering the Bases with the Mets on the fourth Wednesday each month at 8:30 a.m. featuring the Chamber and the Mets. Be a part of our live studio audience on the corner of Virginia Avenue and 25th Street to learn more about the important work nonprofits are doing here in St. Lucie County. Coffee with the Chair, hosted by the St. Lucie County Chamber of Commerce, is hosted on the fourth Friday of each month starting at 8:30 a.m. in the SLCTV studios inside the County Administration Complex on the Old Civic Center side, 2300 Virginia Avenue, Fort Pierce. Be sure to stop in for a hot cup of coffee and hear the latest news from the Chamber and the County. A reminder that the St. Lucie County Commission meetings are held at 6 p.m. on the first Tuesday and at 9 a.m. on the third Tuesday in the Commission Chambers of the Roger Portress Administration Annex, 2300 Virginia Avenue, Fort Pierce. The Board typically holds an informal meeting on the second Tuesday at 9 a.m. in Conference Room 3.
Now for the latest updates about all St. Lucie County Commission meetings, workshops, and events, be sure to visit our website at stluceco.gov and click on our comprehensive calendar in the lower right-hand corner. And if you'd like to be added to our press release distribution list, send us an email at slctv@stluceco.org. We'll be happy to include you. We also hope you'll follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at stluceco.gov. We're going to take a quick break. Before we do, we're going to check in with the latest economic development stats with another St. Lucie Works.
St. Lucie County's bed tax collection kicked off the new budget year in the right direction. For the seventh month in a row, revenue increased, with October coming in at 13% higher than the previous year. Overall building permit activity for October saw a huge increase, most likely thanks to Hurricane Irma, with 959 permits being issued for the month, or a 53% increase from the previous month. Revenue for that same time frame also increased by 69%, bringing in more than $299,000 for the month. The housing market was up and down for October. According to the Florida Realtors Association, the average median home sale price for October was $212,000, up 17% from last year, while condo sales were down 3% with the average price at roughly $145,000. St. Lucie's unemployment rate continued to drop, with October coming in at 4% compared to September, which was 4.1%, and down from last year's 5.7%. Statewide, the unemployment rate dropped to 3.6%. There were roughly 5,300 more jobs in the Treasure Coast compared to last year, with the largest gains in education and health services and professional services, both tied with 1,800 jobs, and retail with 1,100, and manufacturing with 700. If you work for a local business looking for skilled or trained labor, be sure to contact the staff at CareerSource, as they can assist your company with its recruitment and training needs. And if you're an individual looking for a new job, they can help you as well. Visit the Career Source online at careersourcerc.com or call 1-855-4U-2-HIRE.
Welcome back to Inside St. Lucie. I'm your host, Erick Gill, and I'm joined by St. Lucie County Commissioner Chris Dzadovsky. Commissioner, thanks for joining us.
Thanks
and
for having
Howard
us.
Tipton, County Administrator.
Eric.
Mr. Tipton, thank you all for joining us. Now, we want to talk a little bit about the Port of Fort Pierce today and the county's big news recently of purchasing land within the port. But let's start with the history of the port, because as the Port Authority, we're celebrating a centennial.
Which is amazing. 100 years, and St. Lucie County has been the Port Authority. And finally, we are port owners. So that's a long time waiting, It's a long time coming, but it's going to be the investment in infrastructure that we need to change the dynamic and the economic engine that which is St. Lucie County.
Yeah, and the port of Fort Pierce is one of 15 deep water ports around the state, but we're number 15 when it comes to economic opportunity or economic production, but the opportunity is there, right, Hal?
Yeah, no, we can only go up, as we were joking earlier. We, you know, the port, kind of going back to the history, you know, our inlet, the Fort Pierce Inlet, is a man-made inlet. And so the inlet was dug, and that channel was dug, and the port created all about the same time. And so we are approaching, you know, 100 years of this maritime treasure and asset, and we really haven't had the chance to make the great use of it that I think the original vision had. And I think perhaps with this purchase, we've got the chance now to transform that port into something that really can be an economic engine, not only for our county, but also for our region.
Yeah. Another fun fact, Edwin Binney, the founder of Crayola Crayons, was one of the ones that actually helped get the port built in the 1920s.
So has
a street named after him over on South Beach. But I always find that a fun, interesting fact.
And a lot of people come looking for that. It's like, well, wait, who started the crayons?
We should have a big crayon sculpture downtown.
Maybe that's what we'll do.
For art in public places.
We'll
have to work that in the future.
Like,
but so the boy, as you mentioned, Mr. Tipton, the county did agree to purchase the King Terminal, essentially, as we call it.
Yeah, I think it's two things, actually. So it's the King Terminal, which is the only working waterfront at the Port of Fort Pierce. It's about 12 acres, and the purchase price of that was $22 million, which the appraisals that were done, independent appraisals that were done, supported that purchase price. And then there's also a 10% interest in the adjoining property, which is the largest single property at the port, which is Dist & Beach, Inc., commonly referred to as the Bell property. And so we have a 10% interest in that property. And so between the two, the total was $25 million. And, you know, we talk about, you know, that's our investment. Now, with the activity that will go on at the port, obviously that investment does get paid back over time. But the other thing that it does by putting this into public ownership, it allows us to leverage our dollars with those of state and federal resources. And so we're seeing that now in our conversations with the state regarding a $12 million grant from the governor's Job Growth Investment Fund. And that will be used to help bring additional investment to the Port of Fort Pierce and put additional land into public ownership.
I think it's important to mention, too, that the Harbor Advisory Committee, a citizens advisory committee, has been at the forefront of this process for many years, decades, actually. And it's important that we always have open transparency in what we do as a government. And the Harbor Advisory Committee, the Community Economic Development Council, the Chamber of Commerce, and the citizens of South Beach, for instance, have been very important in creating the vision and the Port Master Plan update, which was not done long ago. And this vision is not new. I mean, this has been a vision for decades, and we're what do they call it? Overnight success?
Yeah. Yeah.
So 20 years later, we're an overnight success. But you know, 3 years into this, you know, here we are.
It's the right idea at the right time. You're correct that it has been really a well-vetted proposition that both putting land in public ownership allows you to bring down federal and state dollars. The additional piece, which is working on large vessels, you know, mega yachts, is the one term that comes to mind. But doing the maintenance and overhaul and rehab of these vessels, it's a cleaner business. It's an opportunity to actually create more jobs than cargo and some of the other things that can be done. And so it has been the desire of a number of different committees and different groups over time to see this come to fruition. And so, as you said, overnight success.
Yeah, and I remember some of those workshops. Be attending as a resident, not just a county employee, and people threw out, oh, why don't we get more cruise ships? But I don't know that cruise ships really create the economic impact. No. I mean, you were with Brevard and Port Canaveral, and they really blew up, but, you know, overnight boomed with the cruise ship business. Right. But again, that's maybe somebody comes in for one night, get on a boat, and then leave, and then they come back, get on a plane, and go back to Wisconsin or wherever they're coming in from.
There are certainly benefits to the cruise business side of it. I mean, certainly from a tourism side, it puts you on the map, and Port Canaveral has seen tremendous growth in that regard. But your point is correct. The jobs that we're talking about, which are about 900 total jobs related to just the purchase of this 12 acres, And those aren't county employees. These are private sector skilled labor that come in and work. The pay for those jobs is actually much higher than it would be around cruise-related positions. So we're talking $50,000, $60,000 a year job. That's what we're talking about creating.
Sure. And plus the cruise industry is already saturated with Canaveral north of us, Lauderdale the south of us, and I think there was also talk of having to deepen the port, which a lot you get back to the Harbor Advisory Group, and nobody wants to see that done.
Well, we saw that in the 90s, in that we were 20-foot depth, and the argument was to create an emergency access from cargo, meaning we had to be deeper. They went to 28 feet, and what we have seen is the removal of sand from the system much faster because the volume of water changes faster on the inlet. So now it's the natural flow of the sand, goes south. And so you're pulling that sand in out of the system into the inlet. And so it's not making it to South Beach. And so now we're seeing even more cost, more, sand.
Renourishment projects.
There you go. I couldn't find a word.
Yeah.
but that's a cost. So sure. So now we know that these vessels can come in here at this current depth. And that's really important. Now, talked about the environmental side. Some people know that I've been pretty invested in the environment in our community. And I personally went and looked at the entire construct of how they actually envelop these vessels and how they keep the air and anything inside the facility, inside the envelope. And they have negative pressure. They pull out all the different contaminants that might be in the air. And it's really a clean process. What's more is, when we did the phase one, phase two environmental, we found some arsenic, which is not unusual for an area that has
port.
Well, 100-year-old port, but also that which had a rail spur. Back in the day, they had creosote railroad ties. And so we as a county can now go in there and clean that up and be more responsible. But getting back to the cruise ships, I think it's important, too, that oftentimes the cruise ships go in and they buy up all of the elements within a port area. So they are the profit center. They invest it and they take all the profit back out. Yeah. And so in this case, San Lucie County is investing in infrastructure. We do it with roads, drainage, sidewalks, these types of things. Ports, airports. This is the first time that we're going to be a port owner, and that makes a difference in bringing in the state and federal funds, as Howard had said.
So. Sure. And we've seen that infrastructure work in play over Second Street. So taking a little longer than we thought to work on that. But it's not just improving the road and the utilities there. There's also, again, the environmental aspects, putting in some stormwater retention areas. And anybody that drove down to Taylor Creek Marina, when it rains, you can see just the water sits there and then just runs right in the lagoon. So we're using state and federal dollars to help correct that.
And most recently, the House of Representatives in the federal level has passed an EPA bill to increase their funding for brownfield money for anywhere from $200,000 to $600,000. For small cleanups, and that's basically what this is too. So again, the federal government is our ally in this process. The state government has been an ally in this process, and we hope to achieve additional revenue. The state has seen the investment. They've spent $60 million in the Port of Miami, increasing their opportunity for the infrastructure.
Sure.
So that private business can invest and see that return on investment.
Sure. With the session starting this month, I mean, I know Governor Rick Scott's made it clear that ports are a big priority on his list in economic development in this upcoming budget?
Yeah, and they continue to be. One of the things that our port director has shared is that since 2011, the 15 deep water ports, I should say the 14 other deep water ports in the state of Florida have shared in $1 billion worth of state funding that has gone towards their infrastructure. The port of Fort Pierce has not been the recipient of those because we've not really been in a position where we could ask for anything.
Sure.
That changes with this acquisition. And
anybody that's driven over the bridge has seen the boats. There's been a couple boats parked, two or three boats parked there recently getting rehabbed. And what are some of the attractive assets that lure the mega yacht industry to the Port of Fort Pierce?
Well, if I may, just simply the quick access to the ocean. You're not encumbered by any bridges that you have to go under or bypass. So it is the quick access to the ocean. And I mean, you can go to Europe, you can go to the Caribbean, you can go to South America, and all of which are very important to be able to get folks in and out reasonably quick. And the area of the port is a blank slate. And we can add the assets, the technology that is necessary to improve upon what may be happening to the south of us. And quite frankly, the southern section of the state is completely filled. And so we are a perfect area for that expansion.
Yeah. Talking with one of the boat owners last week, one of the things that they like is the fact that our airport is only about a 3 miles, 10-minute drive from those boats. So it's interesting that, you know, if you have a boat that large, likely you have access to a jet as well. And they do. And so they like to be able to come in and check on the progress of their project. And to be able to get around and not get caught up in an hour's worth of traffic just to go 3 miles. And so the access is easy. The other thing that's, I think, a big cost advantage for us is the price of the work itself. You know, South Florida is just expensive. We know from all aspects of office, commercial buildings to residential, it's just more expensive. And the fact that we are a less cost facility or a lower cost facility, I think, creates a competitive advantage for us as we look to grow this business.
When you look to the bigger picture as well, you know, we have moved into our planning department. Our comprehensive plan has created a commercial resort component. There is interest on the North Beach for creating a high-level hotel, 4 or 5 stars, which is one of the only accreting beaches, probably the nicest beach from Fort Lauderdale to Cocoa, that being North Beach and the Pepper Park area. The other is the city of Fort Pierce has their H.D. King plant property, which they're looking to have another hotel. So when you're looking at the overall goal of economic development, you have a 4 or 5 star hotel likely to go on North Beach. You have another hotel which would go at the downtown Fort Pierce Marina area. That'd be the H.D. King plant. And you know, so now you have those synergies along with the airport and the port, and you have the access of roadways. Yeah. For bringing in equipment, the spin-off businesses that will come, you're going to need aluminum, you're going to need stainless steel, you're going to need wiring and cabling and teak. I mean, you're going to need all these other supplies that are going to be necessary. So all of those elements coming together in one place within a 5 mile area is incredible.
Yeah, and I think there's already been a resurgence downtown with restaurants and places like Sailfish and the new gallery, the old bank building there on the corner of Orange. So a lot of those ancillary tourism businesses, if you know, you add the hotels to it and folks coming in to check on their boats and yachts and, you know, spend all the weekend watching the, you know, parades or festivals, the farmers market and things like that.
So one of the things that we look at for these types of economic projects, I mean, there's a number of things. So you want to make sure that it's consistent with the board's vision and the community's vision for what can happen, the educational institution's vision, you know, can we provide the workforce and the labor necessary? All of that's consistent. You want to make sure that you can get it done. And we can do that. We want to make sure that there are partners available, and we think not only with state and federal resources, but also bring in a private entity who will run it and bring their resources to bear as well. All of those work. But the other kind of intangible piece is the community ready for this? And I think, to your point, I think St. Lucie County and Fort Pierce, Port St. Lucie, we've all been working towards making these improvements. And this is just another piece to that puzzle that can take advantage of all the good things that we've been doing, from the restaurant, from the theater, from arts and culture, quality of life, but also sporting events and all these other pieces. They all kind of just fold together. And so there's a lot of synergy. The other big advantage of a project like this, for our airport in particular, where we are seeing $19 million worth of investment over these next 18 months, 10% of that's ours, 90% of it comes from other entities, mostly federal and state dollars. But it's visibility. I mean, this provides worldwide visibility with a clientele that we really want to be visible to.
Sure.
And so this really is, in terms of synergy, this is really a good fit for all the good things that we're doing.
Okay. And we talked about, I think, with the editorial board, when Mr. Tipton and I met with them, worst case scenario, the economy dries up, you own a 300-foot boat, you still need to maintain it probably, or, you know, so yeah. That industry's there. But if it doesn't pan out, worst case scenario, we have a waterfront property that we can sell that's only probably going to go up in value.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. We've actually seen prior boards take and consider this action only to pull back. And I've forgotten the numbers, but they were ridiculously low prices the first time. And then the next time it was like it had tripled in price, and now we see it again at more than doubling in price. And so I think you're right. I think it's a low risk option. We're not doing something that we're not going to be able to recover our costs.
Sure. We're not building a facility for a specific industry.
right.
that we can't convert later on. So
I talk about it as infrastructure.
Yeah.
You know, the county's in the business of infrastructure. Again, back to roads, drainage, sidewalks, environmental concerns, those types of things. And this is infrastructure. We're creating the palette and the opportunity for private investment to come in and make a business occur successful. Now, I talk about it all the time in that, you know, rooftops, retirees, and tourism was great back in the day when we had citrus and so on and so forth. But today, our business model has changed. We have to change with it. So now with the Manufacturers Association of St. Lucie County Treasure Coast, we have the college, you talked about the college, and being able to create the marine industries training facility, training folks for those jobs. There are a lot of folks who may not be doctors and lawyers and so on. They may use their hands and have that training. So we are poised with any River State College to do just that. Dr. Massey is on board. He's very clear to say that they're going to create a technical portion of their college training. So those who wish to do avionics, or in this case, marine, I don't know what they call it, marine avionics?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know what I mean.
But marine industry.
Marine industry options and opportunities. So, you know, again, changing the dynamic, the economic structure of St. Lucie County is going to help us be successful going forward. And the hope is, as these investments come, we begin to rely on those business inputs to reduce the cost of real estate taxes. So we take the pressure off taxpayers. That's ultimately the goal, is trying to create that economic engine. Sure. That reduces the burden on taxpayers.
Yeah. and diversifying the economy.
Sure.
To your point, if you're dependent on any one or two or three types of areas, you know, and you have a dip and something happens, you've just lost a third or potentially two thirds. And when it was construction and that was heavily dependent on that, you see what happens when we crash.
Yeah.
This is just another step in diversifying our local economy and really our regional economy, because this extends much more beyond just our borders.
Absolutely. Now, what about for those that say, okay, well, the county's spending $22 million on this, and you're asking us for a sales tax? Why don't you know? But so let's explain that where the money's coming from to pay for this debt service.
Sure, it's a great question, and it's a very real and valid question that we need to be able to answer. And so, there are always more needs than we're going to be able to fund. That's just the nature of local government. We call it permanent austerity, where we are constantly battling, especially infrastructure issues. But at the same time, we're looking for how do we build this community going forward? How do we make investments that are really going to transform our economy and be here for generations to come? And these types of opportunities don't come along very often. So we take our roads and drainage and other infrastructure improvements very seriously. And we are short in that area. We went out last year, as you know, for a sales tax. Mm-hmm. That we just missed on that. We are talking again about a 2018 initiative for another look at the sales tax, because it is a great vehicle for getting a lot of that work done, including allowing 25% of it to be paid for by visitors and tourists.
We need to repeat that. 25-30% of that revenue will come from those who come here
and
to
use
visit,
those resources.
Use our resources, and to have them take some pressure off of taxpayers locally is an important part of that.
Absolutely.
Conversation. Sorry. Yep. To interrupt.
That's okay. So we've identified overall in our infrastructure about a $600 million backlog over the next 20 years. Those are dollars that aren't funded for projects. The total amount's actually more, but we have some funding set aside for that. And so if we took this amount of money, this $25 million, and when we put that towards that giant number, you'd still be short $575 million, and you wouldn't be
creating
transforming
jobs.
The economy.
Yeah,
you wouldn't be creating the job. And so what we've done is we've said, all right, we're going to look at the sales tax. We're going to look at that opportunity going forward to really address some of these hard issues. At the same time, we're getting ready to pay off some buildings, and that debt service from those buildings, along with some other smaller dollars, are cobbled together in order for us to make the debt service on this acquisition. So if nothing else happens and we're not successful in the business, we're able to pay the debt without having to raise fees or taxes anywhere else to support this. But we don't think that's going to happen. Just
sure.
Based on the industry as we know it and what we see coming in, we're going to have a tax surplus as a result of this, meaning that the taxes that we lose by taking the land and making it in or putting it into public hands, we're going to lose about $60,000 a year in property taxes. We will more than make that up in sales taxes and other things from the business that's going to be coming in. The economic analysis that was done on just the 12 acre is about $105 million annual impact to the community. You think about the taxes that go along with that, the $60,000 is gone in a blink of an eye. And so we're tax positive. And as we talk about a sales tax, as we talk about using that as a vehicle to really address a lot of the infrastructure needs, the activity at the port actually boosts those numbers up so we can do more in the neighborhoods as a result.
Good point.
Yeah, because the real value too of what the outside investment was going to be, there's going to be machinery that has to come in, the retrofits
like you said,
are going to do.
Aluminum and glass,
all
and
of those
everything
things,
else that goes into refurbishing those vessels.
Absolutely. And again, you know, we see too, you know, the boating industry recently, the expansion of Maverick and Pursuit and bringing Tattoo in from California, those are, again, seeing the value of our waterfront. And so, again, this is where we are, creating that diverse
economy. Well, the history of St. Lucie County, Bacchus Boat Builder, or down there on Morris Creek, you know, you go back, again, given our location, it makes us an ideal place for boat manufacturing.
Some of the conversations too are keeping the fishing village alive.
Yes.
We are a fishing village. That's for our history. So some of that conversation with the transition from Fisherman's Wharf, into the port area, is
a working like commercial fishing front. Yeah,
exactly. So that's where we're going to keep our history.
Absolutely. Now I know the county administrator that hired me, Doug Anderson, when he was retiring after 20 years, says his biggest regret was not buying the port of Fort Pierce. So hopefully you all called it and rubbed it in with him.
Every week.
Every week. It is a huge monument, because I remember in 97 when I first moved down here, the county had just purchased what we know as the Harbor Point, 15 acres, which is a passive park. We use it to store artificial reef and oyster reefs. Mm-hmm. Volunteers use that all the time to bag slimy oyster shells.
But again, that was an initiative that was supported by referendum by the taxpayers.
Yep.
The taxpayers of this county, past and present, have always been good about putting conservation preservation land aside and waterfront property for the enjoyment and for use of that which is St. Lucie County.
Yeah.
And so it's pretty impressive.
So what about the future of Harbor Point? How does that work into the whole port master plan?
So one of the things that we want to do is with our we're not going to operate this property. Our next step is to go out through a kind of a request for qualifications and go out to the private sector and seek a long-term partner that's going to come in and operate this facility. They're going to make their own investments. They're going to do the things that are necessary to make this viable. At the same time, we want to include that 20 acres in this conversation. And so how does that become part of a future expansion for the 12 acres that we're talking about? And so we're looking at commercial marine activities at that location as well, right on Taylor Creek, about 14 feet of depth, which is perfect for certainly mid to small yachts. And we'll use the main terminal for the bigger one. But it's certainly in play and certainly something that we want to see develop as part of this.
And it gives us an opportunity to master plan the entire property. Yep. If in fact there's an opportunity to achieve the other 67 acres that which is available, now we can master plan the entire project and have it planned out in phases and segments. And again, with that private investment that might come in to assist us in making those investments and those infrastructure improvements.
Yeah, well, let's just make sure we find a place to store all the artificial reef material, because I like to dive that stuff. So.
Absolutely.
Selfishly, I know you've been out there too, Commissioner.
Yes, sir.
Is there anything else we want to mention before we wrap up, or kind of running short on time?
Well, you talked about how big this is, and it takes political courage in order to move something like this forward. And I appreciate the step that the Board of County Commissioners has taken in this. We've identified that prior boards just didn't see that picture and that vision. And so it's an opportunity to say thank you, I think, for allowing this project to move forward. It's the right idea, it's the right time, and it's the right place. And sometimes that's what you need. And we're fortunate that we've got the leadership in place now that can help make this a reality.
Well, we're running short on time. Was there anything else we need to mention before we wrap up?
Well, it is New Year's. We've just seen New Year's come and go. And again, my wish for everybody in St. Lucie County is a prosperous New Year. And certainly that which the investments we're making will help us do that. So we hope everybody had a good holiday. Everyone was safe. And let's root for a great big fantastic 2018.
Yeah. Mr. Tipton, anything else you want to mention?
No, I think we're getting off to a good start in 2018, and I'm excited about the future for St. Lucie County. I think this next year is going to be big. In the coming years, we'll continue to see that growth and development across the spectrum, and I think it's going to really lift all boats within our community.
Well, thank you both for taking the time today to come on the show. I appreciate it. I know you're very busy, but don't go anywhere. We're going to take a quick break. Before we do, we're going to check in with another update at the library.
So we're at the Port St. Lucie Branch Library today, and we have been open roughly 46 years, and we service about 10,000 people a month. We are a smaller branch of the Port St. Lucie Branch Library, but we do have a big collection of books. We have nonfiction, fiction, biography. We have a great children's section with lots of books for kids. We also have public computers available for the public. They can print on them. I'm here to assist them if they need any help with that. My favorite program is the Book-A-Tech program. It's the program that I run, and basically what it is patrons get a one-on-one session with me for an hour. I do 4 sessions a week, and they'll sit with me. They can bring their laptop, their computer, any electronic device, and we can go over it. If they have questions, I can teach them how to do things, and even if they don't have a device, we can work on the public computers and go from there and teach them how to use a computer. Some of the most common issues that I come across is people are just very afraid of technology and they're just terrified to use them. So just simply turning it on and explaining the basics of the device is really a lot of what I get. If I had to pick one book to recommend, it would probably be this book about coding for children. I just think it's really important for kids to learn how to code. It's the future. So this has a few different areas that the kids would definitely benefit from. It explains what coding is and why it's useful and why we need to learn it. So this is a basic introduction to coding, and it just goes on to give information, and then it also gives them a little bit of information on a program called Scratch, and that's a very simplified program for kids to start learning how to code, and they can build very robust projects with it. We'd love to see you here at the Port St. Lucie branch. We have a big selection of books, and if we don't have the book you'd like, we can definitely order it for you. We're a very community-centered library. We have a lot of programs for the community, and the community just enjoys everything that we do, so we'd love to see you come in.
We hope you've enjoyed this edition of Inside St. Lucie, and we hope you'll tune in again next month. If you have topics or subjects you'd like to see covered here on the program relating to St. Lucie County, give us a call at 772-462-6421 or send us an email at slctv@stluceco.org. And if you'd like to see previously aired episodes of this or other SLCTV programs, visit our YouTube page at youtube.com/stlucegov. I'm your host, Erick Gill, and for myself and the staff, thanks for watching.